Hachette Audio presents The Storm Before the Storm, The Beginning of the End of the Roman Republic, written and read by Mike Duncan. This program includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF. For Brandy, for everything. Author's note. No period in human history has been more thoroughly studied than the fall of the Roman Republic. The names Caesar, Pompey, Cicero, Octavian, Mark Antony, and Cleopatra are among the most well-known names not just in Roman history, but in human history. Each year we are treated to a new book, movie, or TV show depicting the lives of this vaunted last generation of the Roman Republic. There are good reasons for their continued predominance. It is a period alive with fascinating personalities and earth-shattering events. It is especially riveting for those of us in the modern world who, suspecting the fragility of our own republican institutions, look to the rise of the Caesars as a cautionary tale. Ben Franklin's famous remark that the Constitutional Convention had produced a republic if you can keep it rings all these generations later as a warning bell. Surprisingly, there has been much less written about how the Roman Republic came to the brink of disaster in the first place, a question that is perhaps more relevant today than ever. A raging fire naturally commands attention, but to prevent future fires, one must ask how the fire started. No revolution springs out of thin air, and the political system Julius Caesar destroyed through sheer force of ambition certainly wasn't healthy to begin with. Much of the fuel that ignited in the 40s and 30s BC had been poured a century earlier. The critical generation that preceded that of Caesar, Cicero, and Antony, that of the revolutionary Gracchi brothers, the stubbornly ambitious Marius, and the infamously brash Sulla, is neglected. We have long been denied a story that is as equally thrilling, chaotic, frightening, hilarious, and riveting as that of the final generation of the Republic. This book tells that story. But this book does not serve simply as a way to fill a hole in our knowledge of Roman history. While producing the history of Rome, I was asked the same set of questions over and over again. Is America Rome? Is the United States following a similar historical trajectory? If so, where does the U.S. stand on the Roman timeline? Attempting to make a direct comparison between Rome and the United States is always fraught with danger, but that does not mean there is no value to entertaining the question. It at least behooves us to identify where in the thousand-year history of the Roman Empire we might find an analogous historical setting. In that vein, let's explore this. We are not in the origin phase where a collection of exiles, dissidents, and vagabonds migrate to a new territory and establish a permanent settlement. That would correspond to the early colonial days. Nor are we in the revolutionary phase where a group of disgruntled aristocrats overthrow the monarchy and create a republic. That corresponds to the days of the founding fathers. And we aren't in the global conquest phase, where a series of wars against other great powers establishes international military, political, and economic hegemony. That would be the 20th century global conflicts of World War I, World War II, and the Cold War. Finally, despite what some hysterical commentators may claim, the Republic has not collapsed and been taken over by a dictator. That hasn't happened yet. This means that if the United States is anywhere on the Roman timeline, it must be somewhere between the Great Wars of Conquest and the rise of the Caesars. Further investigation into this period reveals an era full of historical echoes that will sound eerily familiar to the modern reader. The final victory over Carthage in the Punic Wars led to rising economic inequality, dislocation of traditional ways of life, increasing political polarization, the breakdown of unspoken rules of political conduct, the privatization of the military, rampant corruption, endemic social and ethnic prejudice, battles over access to citizenship and voting rights, ongoing military quagmires, the introduction of violence as a political tool, and a set of elites so obsessed with their own privileges that they refuse to reform the system in time to save it. These echoes could be mere coincidence, of course, but the great Greek biographer Plutarch certainly believed it possible that if, on the other hand, there is a limited number of elements from which events are interwoven, the same things must happen many times, being brought to pass by the same agencies. If history is to have any active meaning, there must be a place for identifying those interwoven elements, studying the recurring agencies, and learning from those who came before us. The Roman Empire has always been, and will always be, fascinating in its own right, and this book is most especially a narrative history of a particular epoch of Roman history. But if our own age carries with it many of those limited number of elements being brought to pass by the same agencies, then this particular period of Roman history is well worth deep investigation, contemplation, and reflection. Mike Duncan, Madison, Wisconsin, October 2017. Prologue. The Triumph of the Roman Republic. Who is there so feeble-minded or idle that he would not wish to know how and with what constitution almost all the inhabited world was conquered and fell under the single dominion of Rome within 53 years? Polybius. Proconsul Publius Scipio Aemilianus stood before the walls of Carthage, watching the city burn. After a long, bloody siege, the Romans had breached the walls and pierced the heart of their greatest enemy. The Carthaginians had put up a fight, forcing the Romans to conquer the city street by street, but at the end of a week's fighting, the Romans prevailed. After systematically looting the city, Aemilianus ordered Carthage destroyed and its remaining inhabitants either sold into slavery or resettled further inland, far away from their lucrative harbor on the coast of North Africa. Long one of the great cities of the Mediterranean, Carthage was no more. Meanwhile, 700 miles to the east, Consul Lucius Mummius stood before the walls of the Greek city of Corinth. For 50 years, Rome had attempted to control Greek political life without ruling Greece directly. But persistent unrest, disorder, and rebellion had forced the Romans to intervene repeatedly. Finally, in 146 BC, the Senate dispatched Mummius to end these rebellions once and for all. When he breached the walls of Corinth, he made an example of the rebellious city. As with Carthage, the legions stripped the city of its wealth, tore down buildings, and sold its inhabitants into slavery. By simultaneously destroying Carthage and Corinth in 146, the Roman Republic took a final decisive step toward its imperial destiny. No longer one power among many, Rome now asserted itself as the power in the Mediterranean world. But as Rome's imperial power reached maturity, the Republic itself started to rot from within. The triumph of the Roman Republic was also the beginning of the end of the Roman Republic. The road to Rome's triumph began in central Italy 6 centuries earlier. According to the official legend, twin babies, Romulus and Remus, were found abandoned beside the Tiber River by a she-wolf who suckled them back to life. When they came of age, the twins resolved to found a city on the spot where they had been discovered. But an argument over where to place the city's boundary markers led to a quarrel. Romulus killed Remus and became the sole founder of the new city of Rome. The legendary founding date is April the 21st, 753 BC. The oft-told story of Romulus and Remus is obviously a myth, but that does not mean the story is pure invention. There's archaeological evidence that shows human habitation dates back to the 1200s BC, with permanent settlements by early 900, roughly corresponding to the legendary timeline. Contrary to the myth, however, the location of Rome has nothing to do with fortuitous encounters with friendly wolves, but rather strategic economics. Rome sits nestled in a cluster of 7 hills, commanding one of the few stable crossings of the Tiber. Most of the early Romans were farmers, but the location allowed them to control the river, establish a marketplace, and defend themselves in case of attack. Their small community was soon stable and prosperous. Rome spent its first 250 years as just another minor kingdom in Italy. As records from those early days were non-existent, later Roman historians relied on the oral tradition of the 7 kings of Rome to explain the early evolution of their city. Though the evidence was slim, the Romans believed that most of their core public institutions traced their roots to this semi-mythical monarchy. The first king, Romulus, organized the legions, the Senate, and the popular assembly. The second king, Numa, introduced priesthoods and religious rituals. The sixth king, Servius Tullius, reformed the assemblies, conducted the first census, and organized the citizens into regional tribes for voting. But though the later Romans credited the kings with laying the political and social foundations of the city, they also believed that kings were anathema to the Roman character. The Roman kingdom ended abruptly in 509 when a group of senators chased the last king out of the city and replaced the monarchy with a kingless republic. The new Roman Republic was not a freewheeling democracy. Families that could trace their lineage back to the original senators appointed by Romulus were known as the patricians, and by custom and law, these families monopolized all political and religious offices. Anyone outside this small aristocratic clique was called plebeian. All plebeians, whether poor farmer, prosperous merchant or rich landowner, were shut out of power. It did not take long for the plebs to agitate for equal rights. As the historian Appian says, the plebeians and Senate of Rome were often at strife with each other concerning the enactment of laws, the canceling of debts, the division of lands, or the election of magistrates. The running battle between patrician and pleb became known as the conflict of the orders.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.